So welcome, everyone. We have a next presenter here. I would like to introduce you Vít Ondruh, who is the software engineer at Red Hat. He has been with Red Hat for more than 5 years, and he's mainly working on Ruby-related things and packages. Vít will present you all flavors of bundling. So floor is yours.
So can you hear me? Hi, how are you doing today? Thank you for having me here. And my name is Vít Ondruh, and today I'd like to talk about bundling a bit. You might wondering first why I want to speak about bundling. This talk was actually triggered by recent changes in bundling policies in Fedora. You probably remember that bundling was prohibited. Now it's enabled, and I said it like enabled because there is no rules actually how to do it, or what rules, if there are some rules or no rules, because all the references to previous bundling policies were removed, so we are a bit in a vacuum, and that's why I choose to talk about this topic. And first, what the bundling actually is. So if I say bundling, you might imagine something like this. This is a box. There is something inside. There is a lot of stuff inside, and you just see the outside image. Actually, this is not a very scientific definition, so I try to find out what the bundling actually is, because, for example, in Fedora guidelines there is no mention, there is no definition. So I tried to ask Merriam-Webster, which is very profound source of definition. So this is like group of things that are fastened, tied, or wrapped together. So this is precisely description of the box on the previous slide. Or it's group of things that are together or are associated with each other in some way. Okay, so this is what Merriam-Webster says. Wikipedia, well, no luck. There is actually something about software bundling, and bundle and software is a group of software packages which are sold together and sold actually in open source world. This does not work. And actually quite interesting definition of bundling has Debian. They speak about convenience copies. So the precise quote is, some software packages included in their distribution convenience copies of code from other software packages, generally so that users compiling from source don't have to download multiple packages. I have to say I quite like this definition. So actually why we care about bundling? Why there was some policies about bundling in Fedora? First of all, this is security issue. You will see in my later examples that it might cause interesting issues in various pieces of software. Another question is licensing. I can show actually these points. So licensing, it's a very, very, very interesting topic. We will touch it later during this presentation. Code duplication. How to actually find what is in the software, in the package itself. How to distinguish if the software has some patches applied and if it differs from upstream or not. And related is maintainability in general. For example, you fix the bugs on one place, but there is copy included in some other piece of the software, and there is the bug is not fixed there. Actually, I show you example of this later. So, first of all, this is, I will say, or you might think that bundling is bad. And I will show you that it's not that easy with bundling. It's simple to set like don't bundle, unbundle, because you will save your issues, save your problems, but that's not entirely true. And actually in reality, you see that people bundle everywhere. So question for you, do you bundle or do you don't bundle? Or what is your opinion? Okay, at least one guy does not bundle. Nice. Okay. So now let's look on some examples I met in the past, and I try to discuss what was the story about the bundling, how it started, maybe how it ended. So as first, let's talk about Passenger. Is here anybody who knows what Passenger is? Yeah, Passenger is actually, it's originally it was module, Apache module for serving Ruby on Rails application. Today it's even standalone web server and so on. The project evolved in these 3 years of its existence. So, yep. So what was the issue with Passenger? There were several issues, license and so on, but it was resolved quite fast. But the biggest issue was bundled copy of Boost. Why is the problem? Because it's security concern. As I said, it's basically web server or a web server module. So you may attack it. The computer might be attacked remote, and for example, there might be denial of service, so your application won't run if there might be some issue in bundle. And actually, why they bundled Boost? Because they made some so-called highly Unix-specific modifications, and actually they did it for performance reasons, because Apache or Passenger is a Linux platform, so they did their modification to improve performance and to give higher satisfaction to their users. So, but what was the problem? What was the problem for our users, for Fedora users? The problem was that it took 4 years to pass the review. And although there was bundled Boost at the beginning, it's still bundled there. So the only difference is that there was a lot of discussion, long talk, if it can be upstream and so on. Actually, part of the code, as far as I remember, were upstream, so they are now really integrated in Boost. So this was a good output of the discussion. But at the end, FPC granted bundling exception, and we still have Passenger with bundled Boost. I can see Honza Kaluža here, but I guess that the situation is not better these days, because they include part of Nginx and so on. So yeah, but to have Ruby on Rails or Ruby on Rails application and don't have Passenger on our system, this is big fail for Fedora. So yep, actually the exception was good solution for our users at the end. So next topic, next package, Bundler. It's quite a precise name for this presentation. Actually, Bundler initially was called this way because it allows you to bundle packages your applications are using to into your application, so you can easily distribute it on, for example, on your or on your web server. But unfortunately, also Bundler bundles some software inside. It started, the first version of Bundler we had in Fedora was 1.09, and at the time Bundler bundled Tor. Tor is a library which is used for a command line interface, and actually at the time it was quite easy to unbundle Tor because Bundler was trying to load the system instance of Tor. Once it found it, it just used it. So it was like just enough to remove this library from Bundler, and everything worked, or at least it seemed to work. In version 1.1.4, we are not updating this package for every release in Fedora. So the next version, there might be some versions in between, but the next interesting version was version 1.1.4, which introduced another bundling library. This time it was NetHttp persistent. And this is actually used for persistent connections, so you can reuse the connection, and it improves the performance of downloading packages and communication with server. So this was also easy to unbundle at that time. It was just remove the package, and that was it. However, in version 1.7.4, it started to be problematic. We had to add explicitly dependencies on Tor and NetHttp persistent into Bundler because they dropped there, and we had to provide symlinks from Tor and NetHttp persistent to their original place to keep Bundler working, because Bundler guys, they changed the way how the libraries were loaded. And it was they didn't try anymore to load the system versions of libraries. And there was big gap between next version, because somewhere in version 1.9 they again changed the way how they bundle, and they actually introduce another dependency. This time it's Molinillo. They extracted their dependency resolver, or they built new dependency resolver and introduced this new dependency. What was the biggest hurdle? That together with introduction of Molinillo, they started to modify the bundled versions of libraries. So all three bundled versions of libraries were not possible to remove anymore. Actually, the code is 100% the same. The only change in the code is introduction of namespaces. And the thing is that Upstream had quite good reason to namespace these libraries, because they had collisions. They had collisions with different versions of Tor, which might be on your system, and they were not compatible. It might happen that a different version was loaded prior the bundled version, and so on, and it resulted in incompatibilities and crashes unexpected, and so on. So Bundler itself is packaging maintainer and loader for libraries, so they are on pretty thin ice, and they have to be always careful what they are loading, and I can understand why they namespaced the libraries. And from my point of view, it was good solution. I just wanted to demonstrate what was the evolution. At the beginning, it was just a bundle of some libraries. It was quite easy to remove them. At the end, there is no way how to, I personally can't see way how to remove this bundling, and I agree with Upstream that they have reasons. Other possibility for them would be to re-implement the libraries, which is probably a bad solution as well. So I already mentioned Molinillo. Molinillo, as I said, is a generic dependency resolution implementation. Well, what is problem that I don't understand why they did not use, for example, something as a libsolve, but that's not up to me. It's bundled now in Bundler, and what's problem? It's also bundled in RubyGems. And since it's bundled in RubyGems, it's also bundled in Ruby. So why it's actually bundled in RubyGems? The thing is that RubyGems had historically they had their own resolver. Now they said, oh, it would be nice if Bundler is using the same resolver as RubyGems. So they bring Molinillo in, and since RubyGem is crucial piece of the software which is responsible for loading of libraries and so on, and it's hard for such a library to have some external dependencies, they said, okay, so we will bundle Molinillo and we will change the namespaces again. So now we have Molinillo in RubyGems, and I actually try to convince them that these libraries are collaborating, so maybe the RubyGems version could be just the only version, and Bundler, since it depends on RubyGems, could use the RubyGems version of Molinillo. And they said, I'm sorry, like, we cannot unbundle this because of backward compatibility. Because Bundler is supposed to use various versions of RubyGems and not only the latest version. So we cannot unbundle. And I was not able to convince them to put there at least some conditional, like, we are working with the latest version of RubyGems, so we'll use the RubyGems version. So yeah, it's sometimes hard decision for me and for Upstream as well. Here is actually example, just you can trust me what I said about the differences. You see, just this is the part of one part of the code, and you can see it's 100% the same except the namespace, which is different. You can see gem resolver, and there is no namespace. And actually, if you read carefully, I'm lying to you, because there is this line. And I mentioned before that the maintenance and fixes in code might be problematic. And this is precisely example of the maintenance issue, because Ruby 2.3 introduced this nice pragma frozen string literal, and you can use it to change behavior of strings. And somebody came, oh, this is good feature, so let's change all the RubyGems files to include this directive. And this pull request was accepted. So now this change is in RubyGems, but actually it's not in the Upstream. So I can see that in the future they will release a new version of Molinillo, and this line will once again disappear from RubyGems. Well, but maybe I'm wrong and they have a better workflow than I think. Okay. So let's move forward. Now, interesting things is something which is called copylib. This is actually definition coming from Fedora bundling or unbundling guidelines, which are now, well, they don't exist anymore, but in the old version of these guidelines, there was this definition. Definition of copylib is somewhat amorphous. It is basic level, at its basic level, the Upstream for the library intends for you to copy the source code of the library into your program, modify it to suit your needs, and then release your software with continuous fork modifications to that source. So, well, that's the definition. Let's look on some examples. The first example of copylib I met was OKJSON. It's quite simple JSON parser, and it has no dependencies. And what upstream says is this is intended to be rendered. It's not a gem. Instead, copy OKJSON to your project and require it directly. It's small. So you can use it by default instead of bloated JSON parsers. And the only thing you have to do or you should do is to modify the namespace again. What was interesting with the upstream was, for example, discussions about versioning and so on, because finally FPC granted exception to OKJSON as a copylib, but there is a quite interesting remark of FPC. The OKJSON software has reluctantly been granted a bundling exception. Yeah, so, well, the issue with versions I mentioned is that once you unbundle copylib, you should have virtual provide which says bundled OKJSON and there should be version. And actually for upstream it was quite okay that yeah we are using Git, so we don't need versions, because well in Git you have hashes and you can look at the Git log and you see that what was released when and so on. But actually this provide should be versioned in Fedora. So I had to come to upstream, ask them, okay, if this is copylib, could you please add there some versions? It took some time to convince them. They added the version, but later they forgot about it and they did new modifications, new releases without changes or version and so on. So these are like complications or issues you are facing as somebody who wants to do good packaging job. Yeah, actually, this was another remark, which was still in the bundling guidelines. Like, yeah, the Fedora Packaging Committee has generally a feeling of distaste for this behavior. So, this is like, from my point of view, this is sending bad message to upstreams. Like, speaking about upstream like this way, I wouldn't like to be mentioned on Fedora page with this remark. So next thing, it's actually also a case of copylibs. Have you ever heard about Seekan? Anybody? Better? Yeah, okay, so at least somebody. So it's like, if you probably know CPAN. Peter is here, so and some Perl guys are here, so they heard about it. This is something to be like CPAN for C, and actually it's just collection of snippets, libraries. This is just a few random examples of, actually this is quite useful routines. A lot of times re-implement this list and so on. There are specific hashing algorithms which you don't need to re-implement. Actually, from my point of view, it's quite good if you can take this proven code and use it in your software. So, for example, for Seekan, there is granted exception, but just for not general exception, but just some parts of the Seekan specific libraries. How it looks in real life? Actually, for example, in Ruby is bundled this piece of code. And this is just small part of the... Actually, this is full code which is in Ruby, but this is just small part of the original library. So although this is something like packager and so on, it's quite hard to find these pieces of code in your code. So I asked, actually this string snippet was not approved yet, so I asked FPC for bundling exception, and the response was, given it's just these two small macros, I don't even think it classifies as bundling. Roughly 666 C projects have implemented those two macros in that exact way. There isn't another way to do it. So actually, it was quite strange. On one hand, you should ask for exceptions. On the other hand, it's waved like this, like you are asking and you don't need the exception. On the other hand, I must say it was quite reasonable answer because it's just really two lines and there is nothing special. You can do it probably different way. Okay. Another interesting example of bundling, Nedlib. Anybody heard about Nedlib? It's actually something like Seekern. It's probably older and maybe not that sophisticated. So it's again collection of some libraries. And to Nedlib, there is some interesting story. You see, CVE. Ruby heap overflow in floating point parsing. And in the notes for the description for this issue, you can see this is similar to bug CVE 2009. You see it's like four years before this two happens. Well, so if I curiously open the description of the bug, what is this 2009 bug about? So it's like array indexing error in D2A implementation, blah, blah, blah. And it impacts FreeBSD, several version NetBSD, OpenBSD, Mozilla, SeaMonkey, Chameleon, and so on. Wow, it's quite a lot of software which is widely used. And actually, this is not everything. Because once this was reported against Ruby, it was discovered that there were similar issues in Python, MySQL, V8, and well, probably other places in maybe in your software, I don't know. but surprisingly, although there is exception for Seekern, there is no mention about Nedlib nowhere in bundling policies or former bundling policies of Fedora, and so on. Okay, so this was quite established infrastructure for sharing your code, and now what about snippets? Have you ever used Stack Overflow? And probably everybody of you. And have you ever cared what is the license, actually? So, well, for me, I really don't know. Yesterday was the first time I was trying to investigate what is actually the license of the snippets. Yeah. So once you log in into Stack Overflow, you agree that whatever is published there is published in the under the Creative Commons Attribute Share Alike. But this is only when you log there as registered user. But I guess that majority of use cases like, let's ask Google, you will get some answer. It's by coincidence on Stack Overflow. You get the snippet, you place it into your code and you are happy and go forward with coding, with your life and so on. So, well, for me, it's questionable. Even though, also the Creative Commons, It it has some obligations. You must give appropriate credit, provide a link to this license, and indicate if changes were made. If you remix, transform, or build upon the material, you must distribute your contributors in under the same license as the original. Okay, I don't know how do you feel about it, if you are bound as a non-registered user by this license or not. So this is probably a question for lawyers. Same applies for GitHub. Yep. For Stack Overflow, there is at least some license. For GitHub, they say they don't change any, or they don't take any rights from your code and so on. And if you take some code from just GitHub.com, I really don't know. So yeah, you have to decide. You have to ask your lawyers probably. Another source might be publications, like they might undergone some more reviews than just snippets of code on Stack Overflow. But well, who knows? For example, there was interesting issue Ruby hash table collision, CPU usage, denial of service. Hash. It impacts, it degrades hash performance from constant complexity to linear complexity. And the thing is that it's used this hashing algorithm. And surprisingly, all these languages and frameworks are using the same algorithm. And the thing is that this CVE, actually this OCert was reported against all these frameworks and engines at the same time. So it means even though it might be published in some book publication and so on, once you take the code and start to use it, you might get in trouble. Although, well, maybe you would never write it better. I don't know. Another thing is header-only libraries. It's just, it happens, for example, specifically for C++, for the templates and so on, that you are using just headers. There is like no code. So the output of that the code is generating during compilation and it's baked in your library. So in this case, it might be, it's like case of static libraries. So in Fedora, it might be possible to find them. There are some rules that you have to use actually some specific static suffix, but it's generally discouraged to use static linking and so on. But there are again exceptions for static libraries and static linking. For example, OCaml. This is what is in guidelines. And recent example, Go. Yeah, Go is statically linked by design. And actually, the Go packaging guidelines are 2 years under review. So. Is anybody using Go? Yeah, okay. So yeah, Go, for example, or Docker is written in Go. So we have Go and we have Docker in Fedora and we have no guidelines. Well, but it works. JavaScript. Well, there are like, the ex-bundling exceptions for JavaScript, they're evolving, and bundling was allowed, and this is the recent news, like bundling is, there is temporary exception until jQuery is packaged properly. From my opinion, or from what I know, it never happened, and it does not really work, and the JavaScript is quite interesting beast anyway, because I know quite a lot of libraries which ships JavaScript, but it's never executed on your computer or on the server where it might be. It's over time, every time distributed over network. So there are different things you have to consider, like data size or number of requests you make against the web server. It impacts performance. Another interesting thing, documentation. There's plenty of frameworks which includes JavaScript for documentation, for displaying documentation and so on. So this is again case for jQuery. For example, RDoc in Ruby are shipping their version of jQuery. It's quite hard. It's from my experience. It will be hard to, if somebody will really want to remove this dependency or to replace it by this system version of jQuery. I can't imagine it. And of course, this is just the generated documentation can also contain snippets of obsolete code. So if you make mistake on your, or you have security bug in your documentation and you distribute it, well, people will use this documentation and they will have again the bugs you probably fixed. Another thing, generators. You probably know Bison, Rack, Swig. These all generators can contain bugs. You are using them. So you, again, from my point of view, you bundle their code. If they make mistake or they introduce some error, you have this error in your project. Well, I spoke about bundling, and I see that bundling, we fight about against bundling so long, and the solution, the ultimate solution to bundling is nowadays containers, virtual machines, software collections, and so on. This is, in my opinion, not this is bundling just is in different way. These technologies has definitely their use cases. I'm not generally against containers, virtual machine, or and so on, but you should always consider what you need and the consequences. So I presented plenty of real life examples, and now I have again the question, who is bundling? Maybe have you changed your mind, or I'd like you to consider next time when you are going to bundle something to really think about the consequences. This is like the main message of this talk, and at the end I just want to use again FPC quote, which just describes this topic quite good, I'd say. It's like because software engineering is hard. I don't know, but you can take a look at the link and find it out. Okay, so thank you, that was it. And if you have any questions, if you have time for questions?
We have 2 minutes, so.
Okay. What do you think is the best example when the bundling really succeed? And the opposite? Yeah, you present many examples. Yeah, just.
Actually, thank you for the question. It's a really good question. I cannot say it succeeded, but I quite like the bundler example, because this was evolution. I had the chance to follow the project and see the evolution. Like they first, it was not bundling. It was not really bundling. Then they just shipped these two libraries. They defaulted to the system version, but the project itself learned that it's not possible, because they break the user experience of their users. So they evolved first. They really had hard dependency on the bundled library, and at the end they were forced to change the namespaces. And I believe like this is good example where the bundling has its place. I hate to say this, but I really think they put a thought in this.
Hi, it seems like one of the biggest issues with bundling is you lose visibility into what's been bundled.
Yep.
And looking at kind of the Docker images, if we're able to know what's gone into the image and we're able to track that, so it's bundling, but we know those bundles, does that mitigate it?
Well, I would say you can, of course, it's like second level of bundling, because I showed you plenty of examples like copylibs and so on. You already don't know what is in the code, and if you say, oh, let's take these packages and put this into the container, you know even less about the content of the container. So I don't think that container is like solution to the bundling. It's just, well, it might help in some spaces, but I don't see it as a generic solution. I just see it as a consequence, and from my point of view, or from point of view of bundling, bad consequence. Because there are even different reasons. For example, for the passenger, the resolution could be like fork the boost. And would it be better solution for everybody or for anybody? I don't know. I can't imagine there would be like passenger boost, because who would be the different user and so on.
Okay. So I'm sorry, we are out of time and we need to prepare for next presenter. So thank you, Vit, for your presentation.
Thank
and
you too.
Feel free to grab him in the hallway and discuss this really deeply. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Já to rozpojím preč, takže tu je možná v stadě. A je tam složka na to, takže tam je lépe.
Jsou tohle pre každého z těch tří, takže je to...
Možná to chodně i u Gejsa. Prostě jak to rozprávám a jak to schodí.
Máš zvíčení. Jsem byl na těch kompilerech člověče
So welcome everyone. As Radek Vokal said, if you have free seat on your left or right, you are doing it wrong. So please squeeze into the middle so we can fit as many people as possible into the room.
So if there is such a specific change in the life.